Okay, we're going to be starting soon, so just a few housekeeping details. For those of you who listened to me last week when I said that if you wrote your name down, we'd have a name printed for you, I failed. The information didn't get from point A to point B, so nothing was produced from point C. The plan is next week that if you signed up last week or you sign up today, if you haven't registered, you should have a name tag. Secondly, somebody's asked me if this is a different book. This is the same book every week for 6 weeks. So if you have one, fine. If you didn't get one, pick one up. And if you forgot yours, shame on you. We'll let you borrow one, but put it back when you're done. So we have a limited number, and we don't want people to be without. Anything else? The biggest thing was I thought we were going to get it to you, and I left it in the place that it wasn't picked up from, and so it didn't get printed. And so next week. And Patrick's so upset he just threw his thing on the floor. I don't know. That's why it's dangerous to who we let in the front row. We're going to be using this map again because I want to point out as we did last week, I want to use this as kind of a reference. The lesson today, the second week, week two, is really the start of the content of the book. Last week we did a lot of preliminary work, and we talked about why Paul was so upset when he started yelling at these people right away. And we'll talk more, but today we're going to be talking about Paul's personal defense and the argument he makes for himself. And a lot of it has to do with, he said, if I was just doing this, would I have done this? No. And so that's just going to be his argument. So there's a lot of that. We're going to try and get a lot of this same geography we did last week. And I'll have this map up here, just kind of refresh it for you. Okay, let's begin then. I'm glad you're back. For those of you who weren't here last week, welcome. And we're going to be doing a deep dive into Galatians. And today we're going to be looking at about the remainder of chapter 1 and most of chapter 2. It's probably the biggest chunk of material that we're going to be doing at any one point. So let us begin with a word of prayer. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. This prayer is the collect, the kind of summation prayer for the second week in Epiphany. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may themselves shine with the radiance of Christ's glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever. Amen. Okay, we're on page 7 in the handout, Galatians, Liberty and Freedom in Christ, Paul's personal argument. Last week we read, I should probably get my Bible out. I have a little notes for myself. I write on this, and now I have to put a new one. Put your Bible out. Last week we started as an introduction in chapter 1, verses 1 to 5. And Paul starts off in verse 1, Paul, an apostle, sent not from men, not by man, but by Jesus Christ and by God the Father who raised him from the dead, and all the brothers with me. And we pointed out that the reason Paul is going to be defending the gospel of Jesus Christ that he has proclaimed to the people, these Galatian Christians in this area here. He had done missionary work there, established the churches. Some people, probably from Jerusalem, had made their way up because they believed that before Gentiles, by definition non-Jews, before Gentiles could become Christians, they first had to make a way stop at Judaism. They had to learn the rituals and rites and practices of Judaism before they could become Christians. And so that idea began to take root among these churches. And so Paul is now going back to these churches that he had started. And he is saying, you foolish Galatians, what got into you? How could you mess this up? How could you forget the gospel? Well, the first thing we're going to look at today is Paul's personal defense. And the thing he's going to be defending is his apostleship. The fact that he was an apostle. So we can make an assumption that one of the lines of attacks that these Judaizers had made who were trying to disrupt these Gentile churches, one of the arguments they had made was, hey, who's this Paul guy? Isn't he the guy who was persecuting the Christians? He wasn't one of the 12. He wasn't a disciple. Where does he get off? Where's his credentials? Where's his state-issued authentic apostleship badge? You know, how can Paul do this, say this? But Paul starts off his very letter by saying, I'm an apostle. I was called by Jesus, and I was called by God the Father who raised Jesus from the dead. That's who I am. So now his first argument is in Galatians, in our whole lesson today, really, from Galatians 1:10 through 2:21, is going to be basically Paul's defense of his standing as an apostle. It's going to be a defense of his proclamation of the gospel. And it's going to be kind of a validation by showing his place in the history of Christianity as it's unfolded so far. And remember, last week we put the death of Jesus someplace around 33, between 30 and 33 AD, or AD 30-33. Galatians was probably written before 50 AD. So we're within 20 years of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And this, what we're seeing here, is really the early church as it's emerging, as it's struggling with raising some of the very basic questions. What does it mean to be a church? What does it mean? What does it mean to become a Christian? Who do you listen to? What are the sources of authority? So that's where we are contextually. Okay, let's start off in. Let me read Galatians chapter 1, starting in verse 10. Am I now trying to win the approval of men or of God? Am I trying to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ. Verse 11, I want you to know, brothers, that the gospel I preached is not something that a man made up. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. That is a very strong, bold statement. You know, I mean, talking to people, especially people who are somewhat familiar with how things work in the seminary or work in the church, some people say to me, okay, where did you go to the seminary? When were you there? And maybe like Pastor Jeff and I have this conversation, we're about 15 years difference in age, I would guess, someplace around there. And so a couple times he's told stories in sermons. He said, well, I had this professor, and I came up to him after and said, I had him too. You know, so, you know, there's that professional kind of questioning, you know, that you're all familiar with. If you're doctors, you get together with another doctor and you say, well, where'd you go to medical school? Did you have so-and-so? Have you read such-and-such? That's kind of what's kind of, in a sense, what's going on here is, what are your credentials? And Paul said, well, you know, the gospel that I preached, I didn't make it up. I didn't get it from anybody. I didn't have to leave any footnotes because it was revealed to me by Jesus Christ. Well, we know from other parts of the Bible, from the book of Acts, where Paul tells his story, that when that, and we'll read part of that today. Maybe I'll just leave it till then. But just to give you an idea, Paul, remember Paul said that he was a Pharisee's Pharisee, one of these people who supported both the written scriptures, but also the oral traditions that had grown up. And by the time of Jesus, in Jesus' time, the oral traditions of the Pharisees were probably more important than the words of Moses, because they had grown up as kind of out of the school of experience. So Paul was in Jerusalem, and he was active. He made his reputation as a Pharisee, as a young man. He was a persecutor of Christians. He was on his way to Damascus to scour out the churches there to see if he could find some Christians he could dissuade from being Christians. And on the way, he has this encounter with Jesus, his Damascus Road conversion experience. Jesus appeared to him. And Paul says in various places, we're gonna see throughout this course, where he talks about seeing Jesus, that I am an apostle because I saw Jesus. Well, I don't know what that means. I don't know if he's referring to this vision as seeing Jesus, or if in this vision that Paul saw it, if Jesus literally appeared to him in this vision. So what, did Jesus appear to him in a vision? Or is it in a vision Jesus appeared to him? We don't know the answer to that. We don't know the answer to that. But Paul says, this was where I received the gospel. It was revealed to me by Jesus Christ. And that's the point he's making in these first verses. Verse 13. Well, let me look at one other. I'm going to take a look at Ephesians chapter 3, verses 2 to 6. And Paul, to the Ephesians, had some of these same, must have had some of these same questions, because he, in his writing to the Ephesians, he makes this defense of himself. Surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have already written briefly. In reading this, then you will be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ. So Paul says to the Ephesians, I'm going to talk to you about the mysteries of Christ because they were revealed to me. It's not like, oh, I saw Jesus and now I can make all these conclusions. Paul is really trying to convey the fact that it was almost like in this vision he received this full theological education in the revelation of Jesus Christ. Jesus revealed this gospel to me. And again, we're talking about a mystery here, something that's supernatural. We don't understand it, but it's very powerful. And for Paul, it was the bedrock in his self-description of what it meant for him to be a Christian. Okay, verses 13 and 17, Paul's gospel was independent of the Jerusalem apostles and the Judean churches. So he's already said it. He didn't get it from men. He said he received it by revelation from God. Now he's going to talk about who he didn't get it from, verses 13 to 17. For you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many Jews of my own age and my extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. So there he's admitting it. He's confessing. Saying, hey, I was an up-and-coming Pharisee. I was ahead of most of the other people in my age group. He said, I was a Pharisee's Pharisee, and I was getting a reputation, and I was okay. I was cool. Verse 15, but when God, who set me apart from birth and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me. Again, that idea of revelation, that the Father revealed the son to me. He's talking serious stuff here. So that I might preach him among the Gentiles. I did not consult any man, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was. His peer group, the apostles. These little subtle things Paul is sticking in here. But I went immediately into Arabia and later returned to Damascus. So Paul is saying, I didn't receive this message. I didn't get this from Peter. I didn't go to James. I didn't talk to the apostles in Jerusalem. I received it from God. And then I went back to Damascus. And from there, I went to Arabia. And Arabia is this whole area to the east of now Jordan, and then down towards what would be Saudi Arabia and the Gulf. And that area, that was the Arabia that he's talking about. And Paul kind of went there. And most scholars kind of describe this as maybe his point of spiritual reflection. I would imagine that you don't process what had been revealed to Paul. You don't just process it like that and say, oh, that's cool, what am I going to do tomorrow? I mean, this is a life-changing event. And we can imagine it took, and he says, for 2 years, I was processing this, working, you know, receiving this, but not with man, not with the apostle. I didn't go to Jerusalem. I didn't go to, you know, I didn't go do an online search. Didn't go to St. Google, nothing. You know, I went and I was processing this, what had been revealed to me. That's his credentials. That's how he's arguing for his apostleship. Paul then self-describes in verse 16, the Father revealed his Son to me so that I might preach among the Gentiles. Paul knew his mission. One of the things we talk about, we have a grandson who just turned 18, and it's interesting struggle talking to him, because not only does he not have a clue, but he doesn't have a clue that he doesn't have a clue about what he wants to do with his life. And so we talk to him, and sometimes it's a prophet, sometimes he's, you know, Gramps, what do you have for me? Other times he kind of looks back at me and like I'm, you know, speaking Polynesian or something. But when I was his age, I knew what I wanted to do. When his grandmother was his age, she knew what to do, and he doesn't. And he doesn't even know he doesn't know what he wants to do, or that it's important. So right now we're in a phase that, you know, he's a senior in high school, and God willing, and the creeks don't rise, and his teachers are kind, he's scheduled to graduate in May. But he's also discovered in the last 2 months or 3 months that there's a lot of jobs out there for 18-year-olds. And, you know, he can make $15 an hour making pizzas, cleaning cars. And he got a paycheck just before Christmas, one paycheck for 2 weeks, it was $600. He goes, whoa! I got $600, I can move out and get my own apartment now. Right? Now, not everybody in this room, someplace between where I was, or Grace and I were at that age where we kind of knew what we wanted to do and kind of had a plan, as opposed to my grandson who doesn't, someplace we all fit in there, but there were times when, you know, in all of our lives, probably there's some point where you look at it and say, what am I going to do with my life? What am I going to do in this situation? What's going to happen here? Paul said, with this revelation on the road to Damascus, when God came to him, not only did he receive, not only was his life changed, not only was his outlook changed, not only was his attitude changed, but his future course of life and ministry was revealed to him. He says, bam, I'm a Pharisee's Pharisee. Boy, it's the most natural thing in the world to say, yeah, God wants me to be a missionary to the Gentiles, who by definition are 180 degrees different from the Pharisees. But that's what Paul's saying. That's what this revelation was about. He received this revelation, and he received his roadmap for the rest of his life. And he lived that life, you know, at great risk, and it led to eventual martyrdom. And he just, this is who I am. So these are he's establishing his bona fides, right? His credentials for being willing or for being qualified and certain to proclaim the gospel. Verses 18 to 24. And if you look back on in your booklet, back to page 5. The top half, that's a selected timeline of Paul regarding Galatians. So the conversion of Paul, someplace around 35. And you kind of see from the conversion of Paul, the Arabian trip, the trip to Jerusalem, his ministry, back in Syria, famine relief, his first missionary journey. All of those details are what we're going to look at in these next couple verses. It's that period that Paul is talking about in his history. So, verse 18. So he's in Arabia. He's trying to process this revelation he's had, this call to ministry that he's had. Then we pick it up in verse 18. Then after 3 years, and now I think he's talking about three, we think probably that means 3 years from the conversion experience. So after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem. Now he makes his first trip to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Peter. I stayed with him 15 days, 2 weeks. I saw none of the other apostles, only James, the Lord's brother. I assure you before God that what I am writing you is no lie. So he does make a trip to Jerusalem. Goes back to the home office. He sees Peter, meets James, brother of Jesus. And James, the brother of Jesus, is really wasn't one of the followers of Jesus till after the resurrection. But now he's the head of the church. And Peter, of course, is the head of the disciples group. So Paul checks in with them 2 weeks, and then he leaves. Later, verse 21, I went to Syria and Cilicia. I was personally unknown to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only heard the report the man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy, and they praise God because of me. So Paul takes a little, he comes in this area, tries to process what's going on, goes back to Jerusalem, checks in with the home office, meets James, meets Peter, and then he goes up to Cilicia in this area around his hometown, Cilicia, Derbe, this area, and he begins to preach what he's told. You know, he's carrying out this life mission, right? He begins to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. And while he's there, that's the end of chapter 1. So let's pause him there. He's running around in Cilicia preaching the gospel to the Gentiles. And again, he's not talking to Jews. It means that when he comes into an area, he goes to the synagogue, introduces himself in the synagogue, gives his message, and sometimes they listen to him and say, oh, that's cool, the Messiah has come, and maybe he would gain some following. If they didn't accept him, or after he was done with them, or they rejected him, he then began to preach the same message to the Gentiles. And the gospel was being more readily accepted by Gentiles in this area than it was by Jews, which would be reaffirming to Paul. Right, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. But he still always made this connection to Judaism. These were the promised followers of Abraham, descendants of Abraham. And so Paul went there first, and then he went to the Gentiles. But he's having success in Cilicia. So, any questions before we go on? Any thoughts, comments? Okay, fascinating story. Let's keep going. Chapter 2. 14 years later, and again, that 14 years, probably not 14 years after his conversion, we think it means that. 14 years later, I went up again to Jerusalem. He went up to Jerusalem, goes back to Jerusalem. This time he takes Barnabas with him. Now, Barnabas is an interesting character. The name Barnabas um, Barnabas means one who encourages, the encourager. And the story, as we're told in the book of Acts, is that the church in Antioch, this is really where the Christian, they were first called, followers of Jesus were first called Christians. So this is really the for some people say, even though Jerusalem was home office, the really the expansion west or westward moving into the Gentiles, into the Roman Empire, center for Christianity was Antioch. And the church in Antioch at this point says, you know, there's some people that Paul's preaching to, and if you look beyond that, there's a lot of people out there that could receive the good news. And we think this is what God is telling us, that our mission is going to be, we're going to be kind of the gateway to the expansion westward of Christianity. Who can we get to do this? Like a congregation, except they didn't have a synod office or a headquarters office. They could give us a list of candidates, right? So they're thinking, who do we know that could do this? And Barnabas says, hey, remember 10, 15 years ago, there was this hotshot Pharisee who was persecuting the church, and then he received a vision, and he's been kind of doing his own thing out there in Cilicia, in that area, and he's preaching to the Gentiles, and he's getting converts, and the church is growing. Why don't we bring him in? So Barnabas goes, and he asks Paul, he says, hey, we have a plan. How'd you like to go on a missionary journey with me, the two of us? And the two of them, and he took John Mark along, the same John Mark. He was a young man at this point who later, after some trials and tribulations, is the author of the Gospel of Mark. That John Mark went on Paul's first missionary journey. So that's kind of the territory they're going to be covering. So 14 years later, I went up again to Jerusalem, this time with Barnabas. And I took Titus along also. Titus is a Greek name, so it's one of his Gentile converts, who is now kind of an assistant pastor. And when Paul talks about with the other friends, this group of his followers and disciples, that's Titus. Same Titus that an epistle is, Paul writes an epistle to Titus that's also in the New Testament. So Paul says, verse 2, I went in response to a revelation and set before them the gospel that I preach among the Gentiles. But I did this privately to those who seemed to be leaders for fear that I was running or had run my race in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised, even though he was a Greek. So Paul is saying, you know, Paul had some trepidation about going back to Jerusalem because he had been working among the Gentiles, and he knew that there were some who were concerned that, you know, that Paul was skipping a step, that they were going from being Gentile unbelievers to being Christian believers. And they hadn't done all the necessary Jewish ceremonies like circumcision and other practices. So as not to stir up trouble, when he comes to Jerusalem, he talks to the leaders privately to tell them what he had done. And he brought Titus along to give his testimony, and he had Barnabas along so he could give his testimony of what they had seen. Verse 4, this matter arose because some false brothers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus to make us slaves. We did not give in to them for a moment so that the truth of the gospel might remain with you. So here's the villain. You know, if we have some music in the background, some villain music, because the villains are now revealed. There are some among us who were opposed to Paul's gospel. And the question for them was very simple. They could not get out of their minds the fact that all of these Jewish people that they knew, they all had followed the males had been circumcised, they followed the Ten Commandments, they followed the temple rules, they brought the sacrifice, they participated in this, and that was all part of the package. And that's out of that package of Judaism is where the Messiah was promised, that the Messiah was going to come to be a deliverer of Israel. And now Paul is saying, guess what? I saw the Messiah on the road to Damascus, and he told me to go to those non-Jewish people And the good news I was supposed to share to them was that they were saved by grace, by God's grace, purely by God's grace, nothing they had done. They were saved by grace, and this was made real for them through the gift of faith. And you can see the guy in the back row, you know, hey, got a question, circumcision? Their hands aren't clean. Are they following the dietary laws? I mean, some of them like pork. Give me a break. You can just see all the, and you know, you've been in that class, right? You know that guy. These are the people raising all those questions. And Paul is saying, wait, as soon as those questions started coming up, the matter was because some false brothers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus to make us slaves. This freedom slavery motif is going to be running throughout the book of Galatians. We didn't give in to them for a moment. Okay, verse 6. As for those who seem to be important, whatever they were makes no difference to me. God doesn't judge by appearances. I like these parenthetical thoughts Paul has. You know, when I was taking courses in college in the seminary, we had to learn Greek, and it was very frustrating because Paul failed basic Greek badly. And Paul speaks something like I do now. You know, I have a subject up here, and I'm just about at the verb when I get a parenthetical, 14 adjectives that I want to talk about. You know, so you go, you know, it's not subject, verb, object for Paul. It's subject, verb, oh, there's a funny story, and think about this, and here's the verb. And so trying to follow where he's going is sometimes a little bit difficult. This is a good example. As for those who seem to be important, my translation is NIV, and they have a dash here. Whatever they were makes no difference to me. God doesn't judge by external appearance. So that's a parenthetical thought. Those men added nothing to my message. So those guys who wanted to, back, the guy in the back row who wants to say circumcision, dietary laws, you know, food, all that stuff, that doesn't add anything. On the contrary, they saw that I had been entrusted with the task of preaching the gospel to the Gentiles, just as Peter had been to the Jews. Verse 8, for God, who was at work in the ministry of Peter, an apostle to the Jews, was also at work in my ministry as an apostle to the Gentiles. James, Peter, and John, those reputed to be pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the Jews. And all they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I was eager to do. So Paul talks about this trip back to Jerusalem with Barnabas and Titus to give a report on what he had done. And there's some people in the group who are opposed. He calls them Judaizers throughout this book because they wanted to make people Jewish before they became Christian. And Paul said, when we had this discussion, Peter, Peter's apostle, James, the brother of Jesus, and John, the disciple, the author of the Gospel of John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, the author of the book of Revelation, that John, they all gave their stamp of approval and the right hand of fellowship. They said, we recognize that we have been given the gospel of good news to preach to the Jews. But we also recognize that you have been received revelation from God, and your gospel is to be preached to the Gentiles. It's a division of labor that makes sense. This is the way the church is going to move forward. Let's shake on it. And they shook on it, and this is what we're going to do. This is how it's going to unfold. Okay, so Paul comes. So now after that, Paul then goes on what's called, this one calls his first missionary journey. And he starts off from Syrian Antioch up here. The blue line is a trip out. They go to Cyprus, and they do there, and they sail back to Pamphylia. And you can read all about this in Acts. And there's another Antioch up there, and they go through it, and then they come back. And after a couple of years, they get back to Antioch, and then they report after this first missionary journey what they have seen. And so they take this information back to Jerusalem. Okay, that's what Paul is describing here. But he's doing it, and he's doing this to the Galatians. What did I say we're going to do tonight? Validate Paul's ministry by looking at the life history. This is in the 15 years since I've became a Christian. This is it. This is what's happened. Here's the evidence. It's good because I was hearing voices, and I hope it was more than just me. And it was—I didn't think it was revelation, but
it's funny.
Okay. I wasn't supposed to reveal this. But unauthorized use of your cell phone will receive retribution. There are thingies we've put up in there are thingies up around the room that if they detect you using your cell phone when you shouldn't, it will start broadcasting things that will embarrass you. So, fair warning. That's what I'm not saying it's revealed to me, but it's just what I heard. You know, I read about that on the internet. Yes, question.
Was that the second trip he made to Cyprus? Because last week we commented he went to Cyprus.
I'm just repeating that same story. Right, the same. I think somebody asked last time about Cyprus, and I said, yeah, that was on the first missionary journey. And, yeah. And this, they took a ship here, and they took a ship there, and on the way back, they then took a ship again. So they did travel mostly by walking, but they also used travel on the sea. And I think Pastor Matz is writing the Lenten devotions for this year.
Yeah.
And they're all going to be based on, it's not on here. Of course not. She'll check it up. Oh, here it is. It's going to be based on when Paul was shipwrecked on his second missionary journey. He was shipwrecked on the island of
Patmos.
No, that's where John was exiled. Pardon? Malta. Paul had a shipwreck on Malta, and that's what that's why you have to, now you're hooked to come back for the Lenten series, because that's what Pastor Matt's going to be doing. The Lenten is based on Paul's time when he's shipwrecked in Malta on his second missionary journey. Malta's over here off the coast of what's now Libya. Yes?
On these travels, is this the time that he's writing these letters to,
like? It's after, he writes the letters after he establishes the churches. So I think, now again, if you go back to page 5, where it talks about the South Galatian theory, he writes Galatians after his first missionary journey. So you see that there, so he would have written to Galatians after he'd been there and established the churches, because I'm writing you now to ask, how could you have so easily given up what I had first preached to you?
So he's building the churches along his travels.
Right. So after he leaves these places, he writes back to them. Or maybe they write to him sometimes they write to him asking for advice. Sometimes he hears things about them. Here, Paul had heard that the Judaizers were making some headway in the Galatian churches. So Paul has to write to them to correct that. The other thing, and I kind of have a little bit of personal experience on that. The first two parishes I served after I graduated from the seminary were two missionary churches in South Central Indiana, and not remained real close fellowship with them, but especially in the first 5 or 10 years after I left, they invited me to come back and preach at those churches, because one of them, I was the second pastor, and the other one, I was pretty much the first pastor that had served those churches. And they were both, at least one of the churches, the larger of the two, was just outside of Indianapolis and was in the growth area from Indianapolis. So in the 3+ years I was in that congregation, I averaged, and the church only had about 100 members the year I got there, and pretty much went to about 150 or 175. But in the 3 years I was there, each year I averaged 15 baptisms. And in the 3 years I was there, I did not do a funeral. So you could see it was a young church with young families. And two of the young men that I had in classes eventually went into the ministry, or people that I met, so I kept contact with them at some point. So I can understand that, you know, that Paul would be interested in these churches, because they were kind of like his kids. You know, he had founded them, he had nurtured them, he knew these people by name. You know, he even knew the guy in the back row who wanted to know I was raised, but what about my circumcision? Isn't that going to help me? You know, so there's this personal contact that had to be there. I cannot imagine that he didn't have a personal contact with these. And that's why some of the times he gets so caught up. I mean, it's almost like me talking to my grandson, you know, wanting him to shake him and say, listen, you know, you all have grandkids, you know how that is. Your own, you know, you tried it with your kids and they didn't maybe listen or didn't listen. Now you get a second chance with your grandchildren. And other than people telling me it's not my business, it's still fun. Yeah. I think we're probably talking weeks, and most likely they were circular. So, you know, Paul might send one. This church might have gone to, okay, I'm going to send it to Perga, and when they're done with it, make sure you carry it over here, and then send it over here. And these things, they would go that way. The other thing I read, and I don't remember the numbers, I'll try and remember looking this up, that the average epistle that we find. One of the things that archaeologists do, they like to dig in garbage dumps. You know, because people throw interesting things away and they try and recreate. And so there are a lot of this understanding of this area came from looking at the garbage dumps in outside these cities or beneath these cities when they were layered in the ancient world. And they found a lot of examples of letters that people would send. And most letters were between 100 and 150 words. Paul's letters average about 2,000 to 3,000 words. So he took the letter, as it was understood in Greek, and put it on steroids. And what he was doing is he was using, and it's always sending advice, and he's trying to deal with controversy, and he's trying to resolve conflict. But they're based on the relationship that he had with the churches that he founded. Okay? Okay, let's keep moving. So Paul and the apostles have shaken their hands. They said, okay, you got your area, I've got my area. We both have been received revelation. We're going to sign off on it. It's good. How did that work for you? Verse 11. When Peter came to Antioch, this Antioch up here. When Peter came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he was clearly in the wrong. Before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. So this happened to Peter twice. We know from Acts that Peter received a vision that he was supposed to go bring this message to an uncircumcised person, and he didn't want to do it. And finally, he's convinced he should do it. And Peter says, oh, God's no respecter of people. The good news gospel comes to everybody. And we thought he'd learned it. So in this account, Paul said, he comes up to Antioch. And, you know, he knows what our agreement was. And he knows what we had decided. And so he's with the Gentiles. And he shares meals with them. And he gives them the right hand of fellowship. And everything is fine. But then some of the people from Jerusalem who still were followers of the Judaizers And Peter sees them there and he starts saying, well, maybe I'm not going to hang with the Gentiles anymore. Maybe I'm not going to do this because, you know, I don't want to do what these people will get mad at. So Paul says, verse 13, the other Jews joined him in hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter in front of them all, you are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile, not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to become Jewish, to follow Jewish customs? We who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is justified not by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So Paul is confronting Peter for his hypocrisy. He said, this is what you said. This is what you're doing. And by what you're doing shows us what you are, which is a hypocrite. So Paul doesn't hold back. You know, he's not gonna well, let's negotiate this, or let's try and cover this up. Paul says, no, we have to confront this, because what you're doing is opposing the gospel. Top of page 8 in your notes. This is kind of a this last section of chapter 2 is kind of a interesting what Paul is doing here. First of all, in verse 16, when Paul's talking there, he starts talking to Peter. And so up through chapter 2, verse 14, he's still talking to Peter. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter in front of them all, you are a Jew. How is it then that you are force the Gentiles to follow Jesus' custom? Okay, many scholars then believe that verses 16 to 21, the end of the chapter, that's really not a report of the conversation anymore of what Paul and Peter had, but what it is Paul now is making a teaching. He is making a side comment. So there's no notes here that said Paul changes subjects, and now he's, instead of being part of this conversation with Peter, he is now doing a theological teaching. He's trying to make a point that comes from this conversation. But the point is, in verses 15 to the end of the verses, is really a talking about the relationship of faith and grace and works. Verse 15, we who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Jesus Christ, that we may be justified by faith in Christ, not by observing the law, because by observing the law, no one will be justified. I call this a power verse, verse 16. It's one of those verses that, if there's red letter Bibles are ones that always use the red letters to talk about Jesus. There are some certain verses in the Bible that should be, you know, all bold, all caps, because they're really powerful theological teachings. And this is one of those. You can also... similar verses to this one, Romans chapter 3, verse 20. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we became conscious of sin. And then verse 28 in that same chapter. What there is boasting, it's excluded. On what principle? On that of observing the law? No, but on that of faith. For we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from observing the law. Is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles too? Yes, of Gentiles too. Since there's only one God, who will justify the Since there's only one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through that same faith, do we then nullify the law by faith? No, not at all. Rather, we uphold the law because the law has its purpose to point out the fact that we are sinful. The law always shows us our sin. And that's what Paul says here. And then one other place, the other passage I listed there, Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 to 9. Yeah.
Chapter 6.
Yeah. Philippians 3, 7 to 9. Whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to one surpassing greatness of knowing Christ my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish that I may gain Christ and be found not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness that comes from God is by faith. That emphasis, that continuous, continuing emphasis in Paul's in the gospel that Paul preached. Three times Paul says, no one, nobody, no how is justified by works of the law. And he again goes back to his own personal experience. Look at me. How is the Pharisee's Pharisee? And it didn't do me any good. But by God's grace, nothing to do with me, purely by God's undeserved love, he gave me faith. He gave me faith, and he gave me, with that faith is the vehicle by which he works his grace in my life. It's the means by which I receive all of this merit, all of the forgiveness, all of the freedom that is in Christ comes to me, not because I earned it, because it's given to me, and it's activated by the faith which is given me in Christ Jesus. Paul is not deprecating the law of God. He's not saying the law is bad. What he is saying is the illegitimate use of the law. If you try and make the law the means, the vehicle by which we are made right with God, we're doomed. Because the law can't save us. If, capital I, capital F, if you can keep it perfectly, you still wouldn't have a chance. Because your thoughts would also have to be completely and perfectly pure. And your motives would always have to be completely and perfectly pure. Never. It doesn't work that way. But in his mercy, God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to redeem us, buy us back, by himself fulfilling the law. So the law is fulfilled for us, and that is credited to us by God's grace, and we receive that through faith. So we can stand before God in judgment, and he says, why should I let you into my heaven? See, because Jesus Christ died for me, gave his life for me, and I'm getting in on his paths. Oh, fine, come on in. Oh, it works. But that's what it means. It's not by faith, not by our deeds, not by our following the law. It's by receiving through faith what Christ has won for us, what Christ has earned for us, his fulfillment of the law on our behalf. It's like, there's all kinds of analogies I've thought of before. None of them quite work perfectly. I used to teach college kids, and so they always understood. It's like somebody wrote the perfectly final, somebody you knew had all the answers for the final exam. and they gave you all the answers to the final exam, and you kind of rubbed off their name, Jesus, and put my name, Wayne, on it, and I turned it in, and I said, oh, great, you pass. You're done. You received it. Whoa, I got in on his work, his merits. Yeah. College kids understood that. Unfortunately, the next question was, how do I do that? I understand that grace part, but can you also do the other thing? Anyway, it's that astounding. And that's what Paul keeps saying. You know, we've had experience with the law. Yeah, we know what the law does. The law always condemns. The law always kills. Because no matter how hard I work, how much I try, what I think I'm doing, it's never going to be enough. And I'm always going to find myself short. The other example I've used, and it doesn't really work at all. You know, how many times have you seen a TV movie or maybe a movie where there's the cop scene? And we're going to say, okay, we could do this the easy way, or we could do this the hard way. I'm going to pick the easy way. The easy way is I don't have to go through this. I can't do it anyway. How many times in your life, how much more blessed would your life have been if you would have recognized early on that what you were trying to do wasn't going to work? And then rather than put all this time and effort and energy into doing what you know is not going to work, and say, maybe I can make this work, and then have to go back and undo it or try and repair relationships or whatever happens from it, because that's the law. The law is always there to say, nope, not enough. Nice try. Go back, try again. Nope, didn't work. But the gospel always says, you are my beloved. I gave my life for you. Here is the gift of faith I'm giving you. Live now by that faith. That's the freedom of the gospel that Paul talks about. Verse 20 and 21, to wrap this chapter up. Another couple summary verses. I have been crucified with Christ. And I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. You like Christ? You want to be one of his followers? Then receive the gift. Next week, we're going to be talking about his scriptural arguments for the doctrine of liberty and faith. And there's two sections we're going to do. We're going to get more into some more theological aspects to it. But I just lost my train of thought right in the middle of a sentence. Anyway, Paul's theological argument, I want to connect that to, for us, maybe getting a little bit more practical. When in my life did that happen? Where, some people in other religious traditions, you can say, I was saved at a Jesus concert on July 13th, 1978. At that time, I received Jesus. That whole tradition about receiving Jesus and giving your testimony. Some of us, I know I don't anymore because in one of our moves it got lost, but many of us have a record of that event in our lives. I'll let you think about that and see who gets the answer right next week when we start. Okay, we'll talk about that in the next 2 weeks. I didn't have enough time. I didn't leave enough time. The bottom half of page 8, there are three more of these theses from this book, The Proper Distinction Between Law and Gospel. The first one is really Paul's experience again. The first matter of confounding law and gospel is the one most easily recognized and the grossest, where Christ is represented as a new Moses, a new lawgiver, and the gospel is turned into a list of meritorious works. We see that in people who will say, look to Jesus and do what he would do. Look to Jesus and follow his rules. Look to Jesus and what would Jesus do? Okay, do that. I also thought the answer to the question, what would Jesus do? Well, he would die on the cross to take my sins away from me. What does that mean for me? That's one way of confounding it. And there's four passages there that have to do with that first one. And I just want to read the first one of those. In Genesis 3:15, this is the first gospel promise. It's Satan talking to Adam, or it's the Lord talking to Adam and Eve and Satan, and he says to Satan, I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He, that is the offspring of Jesus, the offspring of Eve, which is Jesus, will crush your head, and you will bruise his heel. Promise right there. John chapter 1, verse 17, for the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. John 3:16 and 17, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. So the work of the law is always to point us to sin, our sin, so that we recognize we have the need for a savior. I used to really do this very dramatically. Sometimes if I could get up easier, I might throw myself on the floor to show how dramatic I could be about this. But have you ever been walking on the street and somebody comes up to you and says, brother, are you saved? My reaction always wanted to be, ha, from what?
Saved from what?
Right? Isn't that the logical question? So, the law always tells us that we need a savior. But if we don't hear that word of law, if we don't understand what it is we're doing is against God's will, if we don't understand what we're doing is sinful and evil, then why should I repent of it? If I'm making a lot of money by oppressing other people, it's good for me. And if nobody tells me it's wrong, why should I stop doing it? But once I know it's wrong, then I can repent of it. That's the role of the law and the gospel, and that's what that first thesis is about. The second one, the word of God is not rightly divided when the law is not preached in its full sternness and the gospel is not in its full sweetness. I always say that Lutherans are very good because we take sin seriously. You cannot receive good news. You cannot be pleased with a diagnosis and a plan of treatment from a doctor if you've first not been diagnosed, if you first don't know you're ill. There's got to be something there with vaccination, but I'm not even going to go there. But anyway, I mean, that's the same point. And the third thesis is the word of God is not rightly divided when the gospel is preached first and then the law, sanctification first and justification, faith first and then repentance. That means it's not going to work if you go up to somebody and say, you know, Jesus loves you so much and he wants to do all these good things for you and he wants to change your life. But until you realize that you need your life needs to be changed and that you need a savior, hearing the message of good news isn't going to be good news to you. The answer too often can be, nah, I think I'm pretty good the way it is. It's only when the law does its natural work, which is to show us our sin, that we are in a place where we can actually receive and hear and apply to ourselves the need we have for the gospel. And that's where we'll end it tonight. I'm sorry I didn't leave more time for questions. I'll be glad to talk to you after. You can certainly write them down in the back pages of this and bring them up next week, where I'll probably not have time to answer them again. But anyway, let's close with a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of good news. We thank you for the gift of grace. We thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would always be at work in us through faith, that we recognize not only the need we have, but also the use we have of the good news. Jesus Christ came to save sinners, Lord. My personal testimony is I know I'm a sinner. I know I need your forgiveness. Thank God you have given it in Jesus Christ. Amen.